Okay, so hi guys, I'm Radoslav, Sandov, you can call me Rado. I'm a solution architect within Softserve, and I'm here for the past almost 3 years. And hopefully today we are going to have a glimpse over the machine learning one-on-one, which will be as an agenda, like divided into three parts. Like we are going to see some basic introduction within machine learning. We will have a basic introduction to TensorFlow and like some libraries that currently are in use within, let's say, most of the data science and machine learning world of Python, also used from various projects within Softserve. So without further ado, let's begin. So, within the machine learning, in here we will discuss topics that are connected for the machine learning as a process, as a strategy in here, and we are going to see a different comprehensions of it, like supervised, unsupervised, basic reinforcement learning understanding, and their evaluation methods, their workflows. And we might talk about some additional methods and strategies. Unlike any typical computer program, as we all know, machine learning techniques will iteratively learn from data or data sets. And there are various machine learning algorithms that can find insights of data. As a strategy, the machine learning itself have different tactics that are used in order to solve a different problem, and they are in a manner of some sort of learning. And we have several streams, and those are some of the streams that are there, where we are going to see the first two more in-depth, or at least more in theoretical aspect currently, and the others will be affected in future series to come. Let's continue with super. Yeah. Guys, can you mute yourself? Thank you. So supervised learning uses data that is labeled in order to predict label with a given given some features. Whenever you have some continuously going labeling process, we call it regression. And when we have categorical continuously going process, we have a classification problem. Within the supervised learning, in the classifications, we have given features, let's say heights and weights, solving a problem of, let's say, some high-level problem of, as you can see, defining a gender on a given person's height and weight. And that's a generic example, and high-level one that is there. And based on data set that we give in there, and having all those boundaries defined for females and males, when introducing a new entity within the premise of our solution, we can define if it goes under certain classification or category within the premise of the set. Another example will be based on general features, which are square footages and rooms, in order to define the house prices. And based on that and other things, we can train a model over historical data and previously label it, and once the model is trained, it can be then used for new data where it's introduced in there. So, like, in general, we have this, like, evaluation in here where we have, like, accuracy over equivalent precision and, like accuracy correctly classified divided by total samples. Like, and it depends on the case and situation that we have. Like, we choose metrics in there. So let's look within like the regression itself. Yeah. In here, we have the regression, and like based on the data set that we have within the regression, like we have some median in there. And when we introduce a new entity, for example, based on this case on a square feet of a given house, we can like approximate the price. And this again is high level. It's purely speculative currently. So the evaluation here and the difference between the predictive state and the measured actual observation is like is like given. And like in there, our differences between the predicted state are the measured actual observation. Yeah. And we have this mean absolute error that we can choose, which measures the average magnitude of the errors in a set of predictions without considering their direction. It's the average over the prediction of the actual observation where like individual differences have equal weight. And like if the absolute value is not taken, like if there are no signs over the errors, the average error becomes a mean bias error because we have different biases. Of course, we have like some root mean squared errors in there, and that's a quadratic scoring rule that measures the average magnitude of a given error in there. And like when you're using with regression evaluation, like all the measurements are based literally on like mostly on averages and how far off is your calculation or like your prediction from the correct continuous or measured value there. So let's take a look into a like generic workflow of this supervised learning process. Like based on the data sources and the data acquisition that you have, like you are implying and adding some additional data validation, cleansing, and different strategies in there, in order to split your data or like to get your data within like two main sets. And those are test and train sets for a given model that you have chosen. Afterwards, based on the training that you are doing over the model and the given data set that is there, like you have your model trained and like you start the evaluation process based on the test data. Like, so in order to recap from the data cleaning that has previously been acquired, we are splitting, for example, 80-20 or based on certain rule, the data set within like two sets, test and train. And within the train data set, we keep the data that we are training the model with. And within the test set, we are keeping values that we want to train to validate against the trained already model. So we can have like based on evaluation model, we can make some adjustments to the model parameters in there. And upon successful completion or like upon satisfactory results, we are deploying the model itself. And it doesn't much like differ from the unsupervised learning itself. So unsupervised learning means like the opposite of supervised one, like you don't have historical labels of data. You have only features that you want to fit in there. And like, since you don't have the right answers to fit, you need to look for different patterns or find a structure or like cluster out or categorize in there. And like clustering is one good approach in there. And like given on like no label given for the for our task, we can let's say separate the given data set within different clusters with similar features or similar properties in there, and then like to cluster out together and afterwards to be post-processed from let's say data scientist, or to have some like additional process in order to define furthermore the activities and the scope of the data set itself. So whenever we cluster out, for example, a data set, we might get something like this, where we have like clearly defined two clusters based on given features. And after post-processing, that is like most of the time human centric, like we might have like different clusters defined, and like the clustering will not be able to tell you what the group label should be, only that the points of each cluster will be similar to each other based on the features, as we mentioned. So the evaluation here, it's much harder. And like it depends on the overall task, and like it doesn't never have correct labels to compare to, so you just have this clustering in here. And like here is just a this is a TensorFlow example that is given in a generic one from unsupervised learning over given data sets. So what's the difference between like the workflow in there? Does that mean that we don't have test data within our workflow? Actually, like sometimes we refer to this testing data, but we call it holdout. And like it provides you like a final estimate of the machine learning model's performance after it's been trained and validated up against like real world data, so you can define in further iterations, for example, different test data sets, or like employing this holdout. And like from beginner's perspective and one-on-one perspective, this is it for the supervised and unsupervised learning. We have like one small topic that we can discuss currently, which is like reinforcement learning. And like those are like problems that are like modern world problems, like give a machine to learn tasks like to play a game or drive a car, or even in modern world like reinforcement learning is used even from our side for collision prevention systems over automotive industry, and like based on like trial and error, which is empirical, to get like the greatest rewards that are there or have like better comprehension. And like as a component of the reinforced sorry about that learning, we have like agent learning or decision maker, we have environment and actions, what the agents can do and not. And like the agent chooses actions that maximizes some specified reward metric and learns the best policy in order to respond for the best actions in future in within the environment premise that is there. Like the evolution here is like much more obvious than the previous one, because like it's been built on actual training of the model itself and how well the model performs within like the assigned tasks. And here we can stop the first part, because like we covered like some of the theory that is there, and we are going to jump within the introduction to TensorFlow. So guys, if you have any questions, like, you are more than welcome to ask them now.
For supervising learning, how big should be test case compared to test data size compared to data size that we are using to train model?
Can you rephrase your question?
Yeah, for supervising learning, we have data suits, and we divide them into two groups. One we are using to learn model, and another one to evaluate model. How big they should be compared to each other? It's like 30% and 70% or something else?
Like the percentage that should be divided, you mean, for
yeah,
the seats?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the percentage that should be divided between the seats, from what I've seen, is like no more than 30 to 70. Depends on the case, but like the most generic case is dividing them 80 to 20, and those 20 to be the test set. And like this is in order to like not overfit the model itself, like in there. Though there are some cases when like using less trained data might be beneficial in future iterations. From what I've seen in the past, and especially when we're talking, for example, for regressions, like 80-20 is a good rule. Also, like 60-40 might be a good rule for classification in there. You might want to like to avoid this overfitting of a given model in there, and like underfitting also. So that is a matter of like, let's say mostly iterations. I can give you like example with one training data set that was split into like 90 to 10, and like they overfitted the model so much that afterwards it was not usable within the production environment. And though like underfitting, I have seen like 50-50, for example, or 40-60 separation, where they trained with so less data the model itself that after that is unpredictable what the outcome would be. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, completely. Thanks.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so we can continue. So what we are going to cover now, it will be again like a small topic like the previous one. It will be basic over the TensorFlow, where we are going to see some basic syntax, what are graphs, variables, placeholders, what is considered a session, and like basic comprehension of neural network within the premise of TensorFlow. So graphs. Graphs are like set of connected vertices that are there, and like within TensorFlow they represent, or at least within the machine learning world, they represent like the biological state of, let's say, when we are talking neural networks, like digital representation of analog neural network. Like in here we can start by seeing like graph like this one, where we have like three neurons and we have additions to two constants that are given. And like what differs from most of the previous interactions of such frameworks and TensorFlow, and also like modern day machine learning and neural network frameworks, is that TensorFlow uses DataFlow graph to represent your computation in terms of the dependencies between in each and every individual operation. And like this leads to a low level programming model in which you first define the data flow graph, then you create the TensorFlow or like the machine learning session to run the parts over the graph across a set of local and remote, let's say, devices. And like if you intend to use the low level programming directly, you can benefit from that. And like higher level APIs such as the estimator or Keras hide the details of the graphs themselves and sessions from the end users, but like it can be useful to know at least on high level what the data graph is or the data flow is. And the data flow is a common like programming model as far as we know, and like most of us are using that on a day-to-day basis. And within a data flow graph, all the nodes represent the units of computation, and like edges or the lines that are connections between them represent the data consumed or produced by a computation within the graph. And like data flow by itself has like several advantages, and like TensorFlow completely leverages when executing like the programs themselves. And the first one is parallelism. Like they use explicit edges to represent dependencies between operations, and like this makes it easy for you to for you and for the system to identify the operations that can be executed in parallel. You have distributed execution by using the explicit edges to represent the values themselves. And it's possible like for TensorFlow to partition your program across multiple devices, clusters, using different CPUs or GPUs attached to different machines. You have compilation in there, and TensorFlow has this XLA compiler that can use the information in your data flow graph to generate faster code, for example, by fusing together different operations. And you have portability. Yeah, the data flow graph by itself is a language independent representation of your model, and you can build data flow graph in not only Python, but like you can build it in Python and store and restore also models within premise of C, for example, or C++ for low latency inference. And that like brings us to back in the days when we had like small sets of workflows, for example, for machine learning activities with data scientists, and like based on some generic software stack or like library like NumPy or like whole stack like SciPy to scrape off different equations, and after that use, for example, CTON in order to execute that, or like completely migrate to C++. This is like the beauty of TensorFlow, that you don't have to do that anymore. And like as any framework in there, like there are two main types of tensor objects in the graph, and we talked about them a bit. Like we have variables and placeholders. And like for TensorFlow itself, variable is the best way to represent shared or persistent states manipulated by your program. They are manipulated via the tf.variable class that we have within our libraries in Python. And unlike the tensor object itself, like the variable itself exists outside the context of a single session. Like internally, the variable by itself stores a persistent tensor, and like specific operations allow you to read and modify the values of it. And like it's scoped out within a session object, which encapsulates the environment which operation objects are executed, and tensor objects are evaluated there. And like placeholder, like based on what we saw and heard about the variables, are like more basic structure by themselves. A placeholder is simply a variable that will assign data to a later date in there. And based on like variables, session and placeholders, and our comprehension of the TensorFlow graph data flow, like we have different setups for neural networks. And like our steps for building neural network are like most of the time, but not limited to building the graph itself and initiating the session and feeding data within and getting output. Like we are using basics we've learned in order to represent this into a simple diagram. I do believe that also this diagram is available within the TensorFlow premise, where we have like variable and placeholder based on some operation in order to get the addition of a given variable by like a given activation function. And this is like the representation of this like simple ALM graph when we just have addition represented here. And like from a regression perspective, like let's look a bit more realistic over it. Like we are using the estimator API itself, and like different higher level APIs like Keras, layers, and so forth. And like given, for example, the estimator from TensorFlow, like we have different options there where we can use within the stack, yeah. Like classifying algorithms in there, like irises, and like we have even like pre-made estimators for that manner within the premise of the TensorFlow itself. We have like train, evaluate, and predict, like both three of them given us as a ready to go models and results that you can use, and different strategies and checkpoints and like data sets that had been given from TensorFlow. And let's quickly show the options. Like here you have like some estimator types, like we have linear classifiers and regressors. In there we can use them like as an overall models and train data to that and afterwards use it. We have different DNN classifiers for whole neural networks that are there. We have like combined classifiers. We have like combined regressors. And like in general, the estimator API, we can like define a list of features columns. We can create the estimator model, we can create a data input function, we can call train, evaluate, and predict methods for the estimator object, and we can train our own neural network on ease and use it for a general purpose computational or non-computational tasks. And if you want to validate each and every, let's say, custom needed functionality or calculation in there, we can use some libraries and frameworks that we have all seen in the face of like NumPy, SciPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, and like so forth. And I thought it, this would be like it for today's session. In future, like, or maybe in the next session we can look upon some neural networks and fundamentals, plus let's say hands-on lab over TensorFlow. So guys, I would like to thank you. Guys, do you have any questions?
Thank you for your presentation. You mentioned parallelism as one of the features of TensorFlow. I've had little experience with TensorFlow itself, but I know that within a session, you can use a specific device on your machine, like let's say a GPU or a TPU or whatever. So how does Python exactly handle this parallelism within TensorFlow? And is it possible to call, to choose specific devices and invoke parallelism from higher level APIs like Keras or others?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Like within TensorFlow, we have like, especially when we are talking about within Python premise, we have like this device switching in there. So whenever you're using distributed training in there, like you have distributed strategy, which is like you can train it across different GPUs and multiple machines and CPUs also, and based on your strategy, like you can use it. You can distribute a function within the device itself, and like how you switch to it, it's by using tf.device in order to use it there. Does that completely answer your question, or you have some still question marks?
Can I use this capability from higher level API? Like if I'm using Keras, for example, which is, you know, based on a TensorFlow backend, can I choose a device and use it in parallel from Keras?
Yep. Like you have site within Keras where you can like run a different Keras, you can run Keras on a different GPU, but those are based on the, if I remember correctly, the Theano flux. Yeah. So you have your config device in there, and like this is the device that should execute the code that is within the, let's say, the Keras script. Yes, so you have like Theano flag for the given device, let's say GPU 1 or GPU 2 or GPU 3 that is there. And like this should be like over 32-bit float operation with Python. And within your Keras script with the Theano library, like you just configure the device itself. Yeah. So in the Theano flux, either from command line or from the configuration itself, environmental, you can like have the device being added. Also, you have from the script. I think this was like in the generic FAQ. Let me just find it. Yeah. As you can see here, based on the strategy that you choose, like you have different device that is like attached in there, and also you can do that in within the premise of the script itself.
Okay, thank you.
Guys, any more questions?